Okay, so can you hear me? Okay, so first I want to get a sense of where people are in their kind of Git knowledge. I know some of you might have just created their account. I just want to kind of get a sense of the whole audience. So I'll just ask kind of the first question is like, how many of you have used Git or GitHub? Okay, please, some use, just try to be careful. Okay, so how many of you feel comfortable to do work on their own, like just kind of like committing, pushing, and so on? Okay, less people. Okay, how many people have worked on team projects, like they collaborated? Okay, and how many people have contributed to open source software? Okay, all right. So the goal is that in the end of this week, everybody raises their hands to these questions. But for that, we kind of need to learn a few things. And today we'll use a few things. So you should see some sticky notes around your tables. And we'll use those sticky notes kind of to just monitor progress as we go. And kind of this is a way to show whether you're done or whether you need help. And we have colors. So this. So teal it means that you're done or you're good, and you put the sticky note like this when you're done so that you show that you're good. And yellow, green color means that you need help. And you also put it here. And Aaron is our official helper who is going to look around the room to make sure that people don't get stuck. But if your neighbor is actually experienced GitHuber, they should actually help you, and you should discuss together if you have a problem. So please just make sure that you look around and ask if you have a problem. Okay, and so this idea comes from software carpentry. Some of you might have gone through a workshop like that, and seems to work pretty well. And we also are going to use some materials from the software carpentry workshops, which are actually here. So you can kind of see the website if you want to kind of have the link to get to the materials for yourself. But you don't have to look at them. I'll kind of go through the materials, and I'll change the order, so you might get confused anyway. So why do we need this session? So I know that, well, first question, did everybody go through the steps to install Git? Anybody have, if anybody doesn't have Git working, they can put the sticky note on their laptop. So one thing, okay, let me clarify what Git and what GitHub is. So Git is a system for version control. I can just say a few words first. We've all gone through this kind of experience at some point of our lives. So the idea is that Git is a system which kind of looks at files and can see the differences between the files and tracks those differences. On the other hand, so that system works locally on your computer. On the other hand, you got asked to create accounts on GitHub. And so this is the website. So this is something to get these local files and publish them online. And you can track these changes online. And that helps you to work with other people. So Git is one thing, and GitHub is another thing. But usually, you use them both, because you make changes locally, and then you push them to the website, and then you start working with other people. So it's a little bit, it's good to distinguish in the beginning, because you need the account, and then you need to have Git installed. For that, in order to test that, we'll open a terminal window, and I'll say a few words for different operating systems. So I'm on a Mac, and if I do Git, it kind of gives me the help, so which means I have it installed. If you're on Linux, it would be the same. If you're on Windows, you should make sure that you have Git Bash installed. If you cannot find Git Bash anywhere on your system, then you can go through these steps here. So in this tutorial, there is a setup. Okay, so this section. So there are instructions how to install, or you can simply Google. You can actually Google Git dash bash for Windows. And if you have problems with that, put a yellow note. Okay, and somebody can help you quickly to get started. Okay, so does everybody have Git? And anybody have any problems? No. Okay. Seems like we can go on. All right, so we'll start from the GitHub website today. And what we'll do is you can log in and you can go to this plus over here. Let me make this bigger. Just a second. I can make this way bigger. Yeah, sorry. Let's make this. So we're going to go to the plus, and we're going to create a new repository. And usually you pick a name, and I'll want you to be consistent with the name so that we don't have a confusion later on. So for this one, I want you to be Oceanhackweek, Oceanhackweek. Git, and you can put your, and please put your initials after that, so that you all have different names. Otherwise, maybe there is a conflict. So I'll put my initials, and I'll decide that it's public, and it asks me whether to initialize with a README. I'll say yes, and I won't do anything on the other ones. I'll say a few words, but I won't do much at this moment. So gitignore allows you to ignore certain files, and license gives license to your project. But we can discuss this a little bit later. For now, just make public, initialize, and create, okay? So if you can log in on github.com, okay, so to get to here, I clicked on that plus over here. Plus, and maybe yours looks a little bit, I don't know. Oh, okay, that's pretty obvious. So green button, and I suggested OHW, Git, and then your name, your initials. The main point is that they're different than your neighbors, otherwise it may be confusing. Okay, I'm creating mine, and you can create. And when you're done, please put the teal sticky note. I guess there's a lot of teal sticky notes here. A lot of there. Okay, that's good. Yeah, just put the sticky note, or if not, put yellow one. Okay, so let's go to the next step. We'll just so now we're kind of we have this repository on GitHub, but we didn't do anything locally. But I'll do a few things before I do something locally. So now Git allows us to have these simple things like I can edit this file by clicking on this thing. So I'll just write a little bit here. This is a repository for practicing GitHub, Git and GitHub. Okay, so write something and click on the commit changes. You have some updates. Okay. So now we have the repository. Suppose we have a lot of code there. We don't have a lot, right? We have like a one line. But the idea is like, how do you get it when you have a repository on GitHub? How do you get it locally on your computer? And in order to do that, you can select the name, kind of the main name of this repository from the main page, and copy it. And do git clone and write the name and hit enter. And if you're in your case, you might get asked for a name and a password. I didn't get asked because I guess I've put them in already. And then the next step would be to do git log. Oh, never mind. So what that cloning command did, it took that folder that's online and brought it down to your computer. And so you have all the files from there locally. And then you can move inside that folder. So I did it using the cd command. I enter inside, and I typed git log, which kind of gives me the history of what's going on in this repository. And I can see that there are two commits. One is the initial, and one is the update. So pretty much I see what has happened in this repository. And this counts for if you take, this was my repository, but if you take a repository of somebody else, you can see their changes. So we have git log, see And if you're done, if you need help, make sure you have the yellow sticky so we know to help you.
So after we edited the README file, what are we supposed to do then?
You go to your Git bat, so you're on Windows.
Go here.
Yeah,
okay.
And do git clone, and put the link of that repository. So you have to go to get to copy the link.
Okay.
So just this main one. You don't need all the. Just
okay.
Yeah,
so from here back.
Yes. Yes. Yes, and hit enter. And that is cloning it, and it's going to create that folder locally.
Okay.
Just remember where you are. Maybe you're in your home directory. Because you'll need to enter now one step forward.
Does it put like wherever? Like,
yeah,
I
wherever
am?
You are. So keep this in mind. So this time it's maybe some random spot.
Okay.
But that's okay.
Gotcha.
Yeah, so now if you enter inside,
okay,
you'll
so
be able to.
Okay.
And you can do git log, and you should see the. Okay, so this is kind of the history of the file.
Okay.
Oh, for your workflow.
Any other questions? Anybody has questions? Okay, so let's go forward. So does that make sense in general? This is especially for the people who are doing it for the first time, of course, right? Wanna make sure that it's clear to them. Does that make sense in general, what we did? We had one up there, we pulled it down, and now we can have it both places, local and up there. And we have these files, so let's start working on this file. Let's create a new file first. Let's keep with this one. Okay, so I'll use an editor which is called Nano. Maybe you installed it, if not, don't worry. I'll show you how to do. So I'll first show you what I'm doing. So pretty much I can use an editor from the terminal. So sometimes it's handy. Sometimes you just want to make a quick change. So you can make it from the terminal. So in this case, I have this editor installed. And I can just write Nano in the file. Just a second. It's MD. So, and I can look at this file and I can write here more writing. And if you have Nano working, you can save with Control O, and you can exit with Control X. If you want to use a different editor, that's perfectly fine. As long as you have a way to edit a file. It's just I'm going to use I'm going to use it from the terminal because it's quicker. So does it make sense? If you have this, you can write and you can save, Control O, and then exit, Control X. If you want a different editor, just open it on the side separately. All right, so I changed something. Control, first if you wanna save, Control O, and one, then you hit Enter to save the change, and then Control X. And yeah. So the idea is that when you do stuff in Git, you always remember to check Git status to remind you what you're doing after every step. I know it's kind of redundant, but try to do it all the time. Where I am. Where am I? Okay. So, and in this case, it tells me that I changed this file, which I changed it right. It shows as red. That's good, because I just changed it. And I want to kind of save this change. So in order to do that, I'll show you two steps, and then I'll kind of tell you the whole, a little bit explain what's going on. So first, you have to add this change with the add command. Then I will commit the change. I can do git status. And it looks green, OK? And then this means that it was added. And then I will commit the change. Adding more information in README. So dash M stays for message, and I'm just writing some message. Make sure that your messages make sense, otherwise you get lost in your own messages, which has happened to me many times. So we do that, and one more step, we do git push origin master, and I'll explain that, but I'll just say the steps for the sake of saying it. And I'll explain kind of these steps. So we did git add.
Thank you.
Okay, can I have everybody's attention just for a little bit, just to explain the concept, and then you can kind of get back to actually running it. So we had several steps, as I said, right? I said I changed the file, I had git add, git commit, git push. So what does that mean? So in Git and GitHub, there are several kind of stages in which you actually save your changes. So the first is you have your local files, and you keep on changing things over there, right? And at some point, you decide that this change is good, and it can possibly go to your final repository, right? So at this stage is you do git add, and it goes into something which is called staged area. So what does staged area mean? You can think about it as you're planning to travel on a vacation, and you're preparing your suitcase. And you have put your suitcase by the door, and you keep on adding things to the suitcase, right? And you always have forgotten something, and you keep on adding and adding. And at some point, you decide that you're kind of ready for your trip, and you zip that suitcase, and then you do a commit, and it goes into your repo, okay? So this is kind of the idea that you can add these files, and at some point you can remove something, but in a sense you're preparing for your trip, and you're preparing everything that's gonna go to this commit. And then each commit will have a message, so in a sense, like, I'm going to Hawaii or something, I don't know. And you kind of, with the commit statement, you get one of these lock messages, right? So for these intermediate steps, you don't get a message for the, so you guys maybe don't see that, but you can take maybe picture after that. But the idea is that you have this, actually I'll show another picture. I think there is some similar picture we can find. So this is a picture for people who cannot see on the site. So we have local file, staging area, repository. And I added one more step in the end. It's the website, right? Because kind of the final step I said, do this, git push origin master. Okay, and you don't know what origin and master means, but the main point is that this sends everything to the website, okay? So now I did that, and I hope in my case, when I go to the website, I have all the sentences I wrote. Okay, it wasn't a lot, but the changes I made locally, they are already up to the website. So if I I can look here, and I can see the history from the website too, now that I have committed everything. So this is my final commit, which I did locally, but it's reflected on the website. Okay, and so yeah, pretty much these are the steps. In the beginning, it looks a little bit confusing because there is the adding and the committing step. So this is this intermediate area, but that allows you to kind of get ready for the next step. So does that make sense? Any questions regarding that? Did everybody... So did people get the file on the GitHub? Did it go there? Did you see the change? Let me say a little bit about what that means, because I just kind of push means okay, it goes up. Origin, I'll explain that. So how do we talk? How does the local terminal talk to the internet? If we look at git remote So if we look at git remote -v, this says that origin has this web link attached to it. So pretty much this is a way to link the terminal. When you do git push origin, it tells push everything to that link over here, which means the website, okay? And you can kind of get things from there. And so in a sense, origin is just the name of the link. And they're linked. And why are they linked? Because when we did git clone, the link came automatically. In a sense, they're together. If you create a new one, you sometimes need to set the link yourself. In this case, they're linked automatically. OK. So everybody can get can push things to GitHub now. OK. So let's do more a harder exercise. So in general, I advise you, if you have not used Git before, go home and do these steps several times. So make changes, add, commit, and so on. So you get used to it. In favor of time, we'll a little bit rush forward. But let me just show a few things, a few little things. So let's say I'm going to start changing this file again. So I'm adding one more line. And I can do git diff. And it shows me the difference between this file and my last commit. So git diff is very useful. And if you have the, usually it tells you where, what's the difference between your last commit. So the difference between, so suppose we used to have some commit here, right, before that. And then we made some change. And we can see this change with git app, git diff. So that's helpful to know. What if I do git add readme? If I do git diff, it shows there is no difference. Okay? So pretty much what I currently have is the same as what was staged. So git diff tells you the difference between what you have and what was staged. So it's actually here, this difference. Okay. So that's why there is no change. What about maybe you want to know some other difference, right? Because there are two levels. What if we, there is one more option, which sometimes it's useful. So it's called git diff staged. And that tells you the difference between what is, I think I got it wrong. Okay, I think this is git diff staged. Okay, I got it. The difference between the previous commit is git staged. And the difference between, if I just do git diff, I don't have any difference. So my file now, my local file is the same as the staged, then git diff says no difference. But if I want to see this difference between the local file and the staged, I look git diff staged, and I see the difference. It's a little bit confusing. Even I get confused. But just keep in mind that, you know, like git diff is only one subset of the differences, that there are many levels you can look at. Okay. Have you made a change after the last commit?
I just saved it.
Did you add the whole file?
I saved it, but then.
Can we do git status? You need to add it because it's red. If you add it. Oh, and if you add, make sure that it's a good habit to just use the name, not
sure.
To use all.
I know it's being lazy.
Yeah.
Alright, so now if I get that, it should work.
I think git diff. Git diff staged now should be different, I think.
Okay.
Yeah. But git diff is the same because it's added. The added is the same as the local. Yeah. So I'll try to explain it again. So let's say that you made a change to your local file. And if you do git diff, you're going to see the difference, right? Let's say that you add that file. Now the file is in the staged area. If you do git diff, you're not gonna see difference. But if you do git diff staged, you're gonna see the difference between your previous commit. So pretty much one is measuring the difference between the staged and the commit, the previous commit. And the other one is measuring the difference between your local file and the staged area. And the previous commit. Okay? So just keep in mind, I mean, this is just use the git diffs to just understand the differences. And make sure always do git status. Like right now, I do git status. It reminds me I changed it. It's green. If it's green, I'm happy. I'm going to commit it. And I'll commit it. New change. Okay, so, and I'll push origin master. So now try just to make sure that you get it at a committed stage so that there is nothing to commit, so you're at a fixed level. Yes. You want it where? Oh, more information? Okay. My advice is just make sure now you get to you're able to commit so that you're at a clean level, and then you can practice more. Okay, so for the next exercise, I want you to collaborate with your coworkers because it's good to practice this together. So Aaron is going to be my coworker. And so maybe you can look at this we just go through this, me and Aaron, and then you try together. You can kind of look at it, how it works. So Aaron is my coworker. And I'll give him permission. So let me, so I have this repository and I want to share with my coworker. And I go to settings. So maybe let's first just go through it and then you do this. Okay. So I go to settings and collaborators. And it asks me for a password. And what was your nickname? What is? Maybe I'll find you. That's what I'm trying. Is it 2A? So I'm adding Erin as a collaborator. And usually you get a message in your mail. So he'll have, I think there's two options. One option is to to go to your email and find that message and accept the invitation. The other option is I think you can get something in your messages. Can you also add me? Don't worry. So yeah, just go to the email and you can accept the invitation of your coworker. But let's just go through this together. We'll just go and you guys wait. Otherwise it's gonna be messy. So you just accept my invitation. Can you make a change for simplicity? You can make a change from the GUI.
Oh, okay. Yep.
As if you will hide that part, otherwise we need to reconnect and all
yep.
So as if you're gonna make a change, and I'll try to bring your change down to show them the pull.
A change to the website, and then you'll pull.
Yeah.
All right.
So Erin is gonna, so he has access, he has full rights to my repository right now. Not full, but a lot of rights. And he'll change something on his own. And then the idea is that I would want to see how he changed something and incorporate these changes. So Erin was here already. Obviously. So how do I get his changes back? You know, I want to, this is very important change to the document. So I want to have it locally. So what I can do is I'll come here and I'll say git pull origin master. And I'll add this here to our list of things. So basically the idea is when I want to bring changes to the website up, I say git push. When I want to get the new updates from the website, I say git pull. Okay, so I actually just did this. And it said that there are three changes here. And it says this thing fast forward. What does fast forward mean? It means that pretty much I didn't do anything while Erin was working. So pretty much all the updates of Erin were ahead of me. So I just took those updates, which is pretty simple. So, So, but the idea is that just to remember this whole picture, when you work here by yourself, you do this all the time. When you want to commit changes to the website, they need to go up with a push. When you want to get new updates, you bring them down with a pull. So this is kind of the main idea in general. And now let's do one more thing. So in this case, I didn't do anything while Erin was working. But what if both of us work at the same time, which is more natural? So he's doing something, and I'm doing something. Which file? I want to change the same line.
The same line. All right, let's change extra line.
Okay. I can even add some extra things. So I want everybody's attention for just for a second, so that you guys see this, because it's kind of important, and then you can continue doing it in between. So what we did is Erin was making changes, and I was making changes at the same time. And he committed something, he pushed everything, and I was behind, so I tried to do git push origin master here, and I got this message that I cannot push because there is a conflict. Okay? I want everybody to kind of have a look at that because it's important. Because you're going to have a lot of conflicts when you work together, and it's good to know how to resolve them. Okay? So what do we do in this case? So I'm at a conflict. I cannot push because Erin was faster than me. And I need to resolve this. There is sometimes Git can resolve it itself, but in this case I couldn't. So what do I do? So if I do Git status, actually, I need to pull, right? So pretty much, Erin was submitted everything before me. I tried to push before bringing his changes down, so I was kind of behind. So in this case, I can try to do git pull origin master. And because we have all these conflicts, the pull doesn't work automatically either. So how do we fix that? It tells us something, merge conflict. We can, if we do git status, we see that there is changes in the README file. And we look at these changes. Okay, so how do we resolve a Git conflict? So when there is a conflict, you get these extra arrows here. Everybody can see them? So pretty much Git tells me what happened, but it's not sure what we want to do. So pretty much it leaves to us to resolve this conflict. And I look at it and I'm trying to decide, you know, what I really want. So I want actually my version. So in this case, you can pretty much now modify this file so that you get to the final version the way you want it. In this case, let's say I'm insisting on my own version, so I'll just delete everything that was changed. I cannot do it with Nano. Okay, I'll delete everything. So and when you do it, make sure you remove all these dashes and, you know, like, you kind of have to, in the end, remove them. Okay, so this is the version I want. And I can just save it as if it's a normal file. And from now on, I can continue with the normal workflow, like as if I was just making changes. So I can just git add, git commit. Usually in this case, I say resolving conflict with Erin. And now I should be able to push normally. Yeah, then I go through this file and I leave both changes. In this case, I removed his. But you can select specific lines. And usually there's, in many cases, you want both versions. It just got messed up. So, and I think now it's OK. And you can kind of, you can continue on with your normal workflow. OK, I'll say a few. We're almost out of time, but I want to say a few things on workflows, just kind of so that you know as we're going forward. So first, I want to just point you to this tutorial. Just keep in mind, the software carpentry tutorial is kind of basic. If you really want to look at the differences, it's very helpful to kind of like, this tutorial is kind of really good. It kind of starts basic, but then it gradually keeps on going and going. It's called Atlassian, so just remember this or like Google it. I really like it. It explains the subtle differences very well. And just kind of here toward regarding collaboration, comparing workflows. So what we did with, what I showed with Erin was this centralized workflow, which we had one repository, and we both had access to it. And we're kind of making sure that we resolve our conflict. How do we avoid these conflicts? What the best way is to not even have any conflicts? Well, one I think better approach is to it's this forking workflow, which it's another workflow, and I can just point you like if you find a repository here, there's this option fork, and you can actually get like a copy of this repository for yourself. In this case, the advantage is you can work on your own copy and then submit pull requests with the differences to the main repository. So it's a little bit cleaner. There is another option to use branches. We don't have time to explain branches in this session, but you can read here more. But it's also very useful when you work with other people because if you start to work on something new, it's better to work on it on a separate branch in case later it's decided that this thing, later you can decide whether you want to merge that branch or you want to leave it or so on. So it's an experimental thing. So then you can kind of work on a separate branch and then submit changes from this branch to the main repository. So. And you can kind of read more about those here, but it's important to understand the difference that there is the central one, the one in which you use forks, and the one with which you use branches. And I think when you get into teamwork, you'll have to decide how do you want to work. And we can discuss it again, because we don't have time to teach this stuff. But it's good to keep this in mind that there's all these options of how you work together. So I think we're out of time, right? Yeah, we're out of time. So this was kind of make sure that everybody gets started. While you work, you'll be learning more, so there's no problem. But everybody knows how to get started. And if you have any questions as we go along, a lot of us are around, so we can help and resolve conflicts if they occur. So yeah, that's it.